I thank you, Hari, for a most excellent talk, and I'm glad that we had you before Lewis. That would have been a shame if you were after Lewis and you just sort of gave up. So it's time to introduce our fourth speaker for this morning, and he is Professor Lewis Kay. And Lewis is a professor in the biochemistry department at the University of Toronto. We are very, very excited to have Lewis here today. Lewis actually has had a very profound impact on how people label their protein samples to do NMR. So he's been a very influential researcher, to say the least. So you are in for a treat. Lewis will be talking on without isotopes, there is no fancy NMR. So go ahead, Lewis.
Thanks very much for the introduction, and both you and Hari for really putting the pressure on me today. This title is a little bit over the top, perhaps. I mean, I think one can do useful NMR, and people certainly have demonstrated that using very simple sorts of experiments, and the only isotope labeling being that which is provided by nature. But certainly the experiments get a lot more fun, as we've seen throughout the talks today, when one can incorporate isotopes and therefore more sophisticated pulse sequences as well. And I really today want to give you just a very simple overview. These are things that most people know a lot about, but I'll give you my take on isotope NMR, sort of a historical perspective. And of course, one of the first things that we have to do as NMR spectroscopists is decide how we want to label our protein or our nucleic acid of interest. And what I show here is a simple situation where we have a polypeptide chain shown in blue. This happens to be of a very small domain, sarcomology 2. And then these white balls are protons, which of course we get for free when we isolate our protein. And you, for a system that's about 100 amino acids, can actually do a fair bit with just focusing on these white balls. And having coverage of these white balls throughout the complete sequence really means that we have an opportunity, at least for small systems, to be able to get out detailed structural and dynamic information over the complete protein structure. And this, of course, is very useful. But the problem is, as we go to higher molecular weight systems of the sort that we like to think about in the lab, having too much of a good thing is a bad thing. And so many years ago, people like Mike Rosen and Kevin Gardner in my lab, we worked very hard to see if we could improve the situation essentially by removing these white balls and replacing them by magenta balls that are shown here. These magenta balls are methyl groups that are C13H3 labeled. And so what we want to do is generate proteins that are highly deuterated, but nevertheless contain protons at key positions, because we've got to be able at the end of the day to detect signals with high sensitivity to obtain the structural and dynamic information of interest. And so we're going to be working with proteins that are highly deuterated and that are going to be methyl labeled. In the early days, this was before one could purchase the prerequisites for generating these sorts of systems, the precursors, we had to really worry about metabolism and biochemistry, which is something that I never thought we would have to be doing in the lab. But what we would do is try to purchase various compounds and then generate the appropriate enzymes that would convert these compounds into precursors, which we could then feed into E. coli to generate the proteins of interest. Nowadays, of course, it's much simpler. By the time that Kevin and Mike were able to demonstrate the efficacy of such an approach, we then were able to convince various companies, including CIL, to provide these precursors for us. And I illustrate just a couple of these precursors. Butyric acid, shown here, which is a precursor for isoleucine, where the methyl of interest is going to be C13H3, and then the other positions in the protein are going to be deuterated in either C12 or C13, depending on the application. And the corresponding precursor for the labeling of valines and leucine is shown here, valeric acid, where one of the two isopropyl methyls is going to be C13H3, and the second is going to be C12 and deuterated. And the rest of the positions are going to be deuterated in either C12 or C13, depending on the application. Now, we want to work with deuterated systems as much as possible because we want to avoid spin flips. Spin flips cause decay of signal, especially as one goes to higher molecular weight systems. And we want to work with systems that have aggregate molecular weights on the order of a megadalton. And so it's very important that we really confine our protons to regions that we want. Those regions are going to be methyl groups and methyl groups only. And we only want to have one of the two methyl groups labeled in an isopropyl moiety. Now, for much of my talk, but not exclusively, I'll be focusing on C13H3 methyls. But nowadays, one can buy precursors that are C13HD2 or C13H2D. And for various applications, as I'll illustrate, these precursors can be very useful as well. And this is just an example of the sort of spectra that one can generate. This is a carbon proton correlation map on malate synthase G, which is 82 kilodaltons and 700 plus residues. It was considered very big in the lab some 15 years ago or so when Vitelli was working on this system. And using technologies that we published over the years, we've been able to assign something like 95% of these methyl groups to specific sites in the molecule. And these then serve as probes of molecular structure and dynamics. So this is how we go about labeling proteins. It's now a very well-established procedure, and many groups have made contributions to this methodology and have demonstrated utility with a variety of many different applications now. Now, we were also very interested in bringing a methyl labeling to the realm of nucleic acids because we wanted to work with very large nucleic acids in the context of, say, nucleoprotein complexes like the nucleosome core particle. And the question is, how should we label these amino acids? Well, we can uniformly C13 label or label these nucleic acids, sorry. One can uniformly C13 label the nucleic acids, or one can focus, say, on labeling methyl groups. All of the methyls in T, for example, could be C13H3. But the problem is that if you only have four nucleobases, even if you have a 1.2 or a 1.5 eventually gigahertz spectrometer, you're not going to have the resolution to be able to specifically delve into sites in the structure. And so what we wanted to do then in terms of labeling actually is not be original at all, but borrow an idea that Mother Nature has put forth and simply try to replicate it. Now, if we look at, say, epigenetic modification of DNA in the context of eukaryotes, this is used to regulate transcription and translation, to control phase separation, and therefore nucleic acid metabolism. In the context of bacterial systems, however, methyl labeling is also very important and is a sort of a primitive immune system that bacteria use. So that there's methyl labeling occurs at the level of a number of bases, for example, the C5 position of cytosine, or the 6 position in adenine, or the 4 position in cytosine. And these are affixed to the bases through the action of enzymes called methyl transferases. Now, for every methyl transferase in a bacteria, there's also a restriction endonuclease. And the idea is that once you methylate your DNA, the restriction endonuclease can no longer chop it up. That's very good for the host, but if the host is then going to be attacked by another bacterium or by a bacteriophage, the DNA would be injected, the foreign DNA, it wouldn't contain the appropriate methyl labels, and therefore it would be attacked and degraded by a restriction endonucleases. And so we want to exploit these methyl transferases that Mother Nature has provided us with in order to generate methyl-labeled DNAs that we can then study. And the approach is really very simple. We want to do a one-pot reaction. We want to biosynthetically produce the enzymes that are necessary to generate the labeled DNA. And so we purchase a C13H3 methionine, which is very cheap. We have ATP. We generate an enzyme called S-adenosyl methionine synthase, which is going to produce the methyl group on S-adenosyl methionine, which we add then to the DNA of interest with the methyl transferases of interest. The methyl transferases are then going to take the methyl group associated with SAM and then going to specifically label the nucleobase of interest. We're going to prepare the DNA with the appropriate recognition sequences for the various methyl transferases that we want to work with. So we're going to label, say, 4 or 5 a half a dozen positions in our DNA with C13H3 methyl groups that then serve as probes, hopefully in key regions. that will inform on structural dynamics, again, in the context of these very large systems. So just an illustration demonstrating that this works, we can basically take a methyltransferase, DCM, DNA shown here, which initially wouldn't be methyl labeled. We're going to add C13H3 methionine as a function of time through the action of S-adenosyl methionine synthase. The methionine is going to decrease in intensity, the methionine peak, by virtue of the fact that we're creating this product, S-adenosyl methionine, which then in turn, through the action of methyltransferases, is going to react with DNA to form the methyl group on the nucleobase base in question. So we have a decrease in our methionine peak, our increase in our SAM peak, and then subsequently the increase in the peaks that correspond to the methyl label affixed to the DNA as shown here. So we can produce, therefore, DNAs of interest using this approach. Of course, the DNAs have to have a recognition sequence for the particular methyl transferase in question. What we've done is we've generated a library of various methyl transferases, various enzymes shown here are three enzymes, DCM, MSP, and 1ML, that are going to affix a C13H3 methyl group to cytosine indicated here. And we also have the corresponding methyl transferases, which do the same thing, but with A, with the N6 position in A. So we can generate really quite nice spectra. These are obviously just on small fragments of DNA, but they certainly illustrate the fact that these methyl transferases are effective. And moreover, that the resolution is sufficient. This is recorded at, I think, 800 megahertz, but even at 500 megahertz, the resolution would be sufficient for judicious choice of methyl groups with various methyl transferases to be able to label in a multiple way several sites along the DNA with methyl probes. And an example of this in the context of a 200 kilodalton particle or so, this is the nucleosome core particle where we've labeled ILVs, one of the proteinaceous components of this nucleoprotein complex. NCPs are comprised of two copies each of four different histones, H2A, H2B, H3, and H4. We've labeled H2B with the ILV methyl labeling approach. And then we have something like five different sites on the DNA, which we've labeled with C13H3. And then we can use the plethora of different experiments that we and others have developed over several decades now that allow us to focus on dynamics. In particular, in this experiment, this is a triple quantum based experiment, which provides through measuring cross-correlated spin relaxation of proton-proton dipolar interactions that manifest within the context of a methyl group, we can get out order parameters. And that's plotted here where you can see in red the order parameters for the protein component. And this is H2B. And there's a wide distribution of order parameters from essentially zero all the way to one. And then you can see that the order parameters that are associated with the methyls of the DNA tend to be in general, quite a bit larger towards 1 or 0.9 or so. So we have different degrees of ordering that the methyl groups can report on. And the question is, why do we work with these methyl groups? What's so attractive about these methyls? And the answer is that they are very amenable to spin alchemy. We can manipulate the spin physics in ways that allow us to exploit the labeling. Let me just illustrate that for you by a very simple analogy, focusing on C13H2 methylene groups for a moment, and then we'll make the jump to methyl groups. So that if one looks at a carbon spectrum of a C13H2 methylene group, one would end up with a 1-to-2-to-1 triplet structure. This is a small molecule, so the line widths would be roughly the same. By contrast, if we look at a large molecule, and again, focus on a methylene group, and this is a methylene group which is fairly rigidly affixed in the context of the large molecule, one still ends up with a triplet structure, but now more or less a 1-to-1-to-1 triplet structure, whereby the central line is going to be twice broader than the outer two lines. By contrast, if one looks at a methylene group, but now one which is averaged, such that we have rotation about an axis whereby each of the two carbon proton vectors associated with the methylene make equiprojections about the averaging axis, So you can think about a fatty acid in the context of a biological membrane where one has very rapid rotation about the long axis of the fatty acid. Then if one focuses just on the proton-carbon dipolar interactions, one can show that the middle line is essentially immortalized. There's no relaxation contributions whatsoever. And so this is a very nice situation. The problem is that whilst we have methylene groups in the context of proteins, they don't behave with this sort of averaging. They're much more like this rigid structure, and the methylene signals would completely essentially decay away for applications to large protein systems. By contrast, if we could work, say, with a methyl group, methyl groups already have built in this sort of mobility illustrated here. So there's very rapid rotation about the methyl threefold. That's good. The bad thing is that a methyl is not a methylene. So somehow we have to convince the methyl group that it's a methylene for part of the experiment. And of course, as many of us know now and have exploited, that's actually possible through an HMQC pulse sequence, which essentially creates a superspin that involves a carbon in one of the protons, so that we're left with two protons, these black protons on the side, which give rise to a triplet structure, which looks just like that which we would get for a methylene. And this is just illustrated here. We have acetic acid, the HMQC-based experiment, if you like, where we focus on the evolution of the carbon-proton superspin. This is, of course, incredibly qualitative and superficial, but we end up with a 1-to-2-to-1 triplet structure, acetic acid being very small, of course. If we then apply this to a protein, malate synthase J, which is 723 residues, what Vitali noticed is that the outer lines essentially decay away, and we have this very big line in the middle, as would be predicted from Redfield theory, that we can exploit to study very large systems. And so this slide here just illustrates the roles of isotopes in structural dynamics working on supramolecular systems, in particular P97, which is a hexameric machine. It's a homeostasis protein. We look at a version of it often that's 320 kilodaltons in molecular weight. We're able to produce ILV labeled, also methionine labeled proteins. These are pro-R labeled systems. So we're able not only to C13H3 generate C13H3 labels in our system, but at the pro-R position or the pro-S positions. These can now be purchased, the precursors that are involved there. And we can then study structural dynamics, which have a very important undercurrent in understanding disease. For example, if we look at these structures of P97, they're hexameric. And in the ADP form, you can see these blue elements. These are N-terminal domains, which I depict here by this blue ball. There would be essentially one blue ball for every one of the six protomers. They're in the down position in ADP. They're in the up position in ATP. And as a function of a series of disease mutants called a multi-system proteinopathy, the equilibrium in the ADP form, which in the wild type situation is all down, becomes, as a function of increasing disease severity, essentially up. So one has an aberrant equilibrium, which has very significant downstream applications and, of course, very significant phenotypes leading ultimately to death. So an example of where NMR and isotopes can very significantly contribute. We can also use NMR and isotopes to see that which is invisible. And let me just introduce chemical exchange saturation transfer, which is a very, very old NMR experiment that goes back over a half century, but is a very powerful one. If we think about C13 NMR spectroscopy, and in particular in the context of an exchanging system whereby one has a ground conformation, which is highly populated, that exchanges to an excited state, which is sparsely populated, so that we can't see any of the peaks of the excited state, but only of the ground state, we may want to get the structure of the excited state. In fact, much of, or at least some of biology occurs at the level of these excited states, despite the fact that they may only be populated at 0.5% and have lifetimes on the order of 1/10 of a millisecond. So we would like to be able to study these excited states. And one of the way that we can do it, if the time scale is amenable, is via this chemical exchange saturation transfer. And so let me just show you the spectrum, the carbon spectrum, focusing only on a single C13 spin, Of course, typically we would have many such spins in the context of a protein or a nucleic acid, but if we focus just on one spin, and what I show here in blue is the position of the carbon frequency in the context of the ground state, that's what we can see, in red in the context of the excited state. I show it here merely for the purposes of description and explanation of the underpinnings of the experiment, but typically we would not be able to see any of these red peaks. And so what we do is we take a very weak magnetic field and we go on a treasure hunt, if you like. We place the magnetic field at different positions along the carbon frequency, and then we ask the question, whereabouts at a given position do we see a change in the blue peak? The blue peak is the only peak that we can observe. Whereabouts do we get a change in the position of the blue peak due to the positioning of the green, sorry about that, due to the position of the weak green magnetic field? Now, if we have the green magnetic field that is placed right here, away from the red and the blue peaks, then there's no change in the intensity of the blue peak. But if we position the green field, the weak magnetic field, right on top of the red peak, then we're going to observe a diminution of a decrease in the intensity of the blue peak by virtue of the fact that the perturbation that is exerted on the red peak due to the weak B1 field, that perturbation through chemical exchange is going to transfer to the blue peak. And so if we plot the intensity of the blue peak as a function of the position of the green peak, we will get a dip corresponding to the resonance frequency of the excited state, and then a much larger dip corresponding to the resonance frequency of the ground state. So we will get these pairs of dips where we can therefore immediately read off the chemical shift of the excited state.
Lewis, sorry to interrupt, but you have 2 minutes.
Okay, perfect. This is a powerful experiment, and I want to illustrate the importance not only of isotopes, but also of spin physics. So suppose that we have a uniformly a C13 labeled protein, and we want to do an experiment that actually looks for these invisible states. One of the experiments that we can do is called CPMG. It's a relaxation dispersion-based experiment that essentially applies a series of pulses that refocus chemical shifts. And by applying these pulses at different rates, we can learn something about chemical exchange. So suppose that we have a fragment that is comprised of, say, two carbons, carbon A and carbon B. They're both C13 labeled. The ground state is 95% populated. The excited state is 5% populated. We have exchange, and we carry out this CPMG experiment. And we measure essentially the line width as a function of the number of pulses that we apply. That's what one does in a CPMG experiment. What I want to emphasize is that by virtue of the fact that there's a strong coupling between A and B, scalar coupling, we end up in shown here in red with a very strange profile. The profile that we want to see that is essentially the result of exchange is shown when we set this coupling to zero and get the gray curve shown here, which looks like this. So we have a CPMG experiment that simply won't work if we have uniform C13 labeling. Of course, we can eliminate some of the couplings through isotopes or via selective pulses in some cases, but we can also do the CEST experiment where we use very, very weak magnetic fields. And so the scalar coupling really doesn't manifest and we can get the detailed information. So an important take home from this is that isotopes are critical, but so is the spin physics. And that allows us, for example, to look at the side chains of a protein and to get out the excited state chemical shifts of the C betas, the C alphas, the C deltas, and so forth in leucine 18 of this protein that exchanges between a ground and excited state. On my last slide, let me also emphasize that whilst C13H3 methyls are wonderful, for some applications, we want to throw in a couple of deuterons and work with C13HD2 methyl groups. And that can generate a spectra of much higher sensitivity. And one example, again, is in the context of chemical exchange saturation transfer, working with methyl groups, there's a real big difference in sensitivity. And I just illustrate that here. This is a carbon proton correlation map of a small protein, actually. And this is essentially what we get if we work with a C13H3 or a C13HD2 spin system. We're looking at leucine 29, the delta 2 position. And in red, what I show is the peaks that we get for the C13H3 group, where we use a mixing time of zero or a mixing time of several hundred milliseconds. One needs a mixing time in these CEST experiments because we need to have time for the system to exchange between the interconverting states. By contrast, if we record the spectrum not with C13H3, but with C13HD2, the sensitivity in blue you can see is much higher in red. And when we quantify that, we gain roughly factors of three all the way up to about an order of magnitude in sensitivity. And so it's important not only to think about the labeling and the spin physics, but really putting them together, because for certain applications, C13H3 is better. For other applications, C13HD2 is going to be the preferred choice. So let me just conclude. I hope I've indicated that isotopes are very valuable in studies of molecular systems, be they high molecular weight objects or exchange, to look at the structures of invisible states, which play an important role in biology for certain. And companies like CIL, of course, have been very responsive to our needs for essentially three decades. I thank CIL and other companies, and of course, especially members of my laboratory over a period of three decades who have contributed immensely to the fun that we've had with isotopes. Thanks very much.
All right, thanks, Lewis. That was an excellent talk, as always. We have time for one short question. And the question is, as always, inspiring talk. My question is, can the CH-H2, quote unquote, superspin approach be used to improve higher order structure fingerprinting of non-deuterated therapeutic monoclonal antibodies at natural 13C abundance?
Huh, great question. So we're not certainly doing that, but people at NIST in Maryland are precisely doing that. And in fact, Frank DeLaglio gave a talk last week, where he showed spectra of antibodies where people are using the methyl approach. And so that talk, I think, was recorded. It was one of these Thursday ICMRBS, a couple of lectures in an hour Thursday morning. And so I would encourage you to look there. I think people are definitely doing these sorts of experiments at natural abundance and exploiting the fact that methyls give really high sensitivity.
That's great. That's very encouraging. Well, thank you again, Lewis, for your wonderful talk.
Pleasure.